These are the mountains of East Central Idaho, about 10 miles southwest of the town of Challis. We're looking down here at Malm Gulch. This is gonna be probably a two-part video series. The second part's gonna showcase some of these volcanic rocks. And the real highlight here is the petrified sequoia stumps that I'll show in part two. But I wanted to focus this first video on a really remarkable relationship between some rocks up here just behind me. And I'll show you the rocks here in a second, but I think I want to start with a good regional overview here. Everything behind me is what's known as the Challis Volcanics. The Challis Volcanics is a thick blanket of all sorts of volcanic rocks that cover much of central and eastern Idaho. It's a really common rock that we see in the area. It's very widespread. And I'm not going to get into the tectonic setting as much, but suffice it to say, the Challis Volcanics are a set of rocks that were deposited or laid down during a period of extension. So east-west extension, but not the basin and range extension, produced magmas of various compositions that formed volcanic eruptions in this region. And I want to first start with a little bit of a diagram that I hope shows some of the variety here. And so what I've got here is a cartoon, a pretty intricate cartoon, kind of a cross section from west to east. And what I want to show here is some of the variety of volcanoes that formed in the Challis Volcanic. First of all, to our west, we have the granites of the Idaho batholith. So the granites you see over north of Boise, and that make up much of the core, the wilderness of the central part of the state. Those are all these Cretaceous age granites, maybe anywhere from 100 to 80 or so million years ago. As you move eastward, you leave the Idaho batholith and you run into older Paleozoic sedimentary rocks that are folded and faulted by the severe orogeny. And I'm going to show you some of those here in a second. But the main thing we want to look at here is the Challis Volcanics. The Challis Volcanics cover these rocks, and there was already a topographic surface here. So there was already hills and valleys, that sort of thing. And the first thing that happened as the Challis Volcanic episode began was the deposition of a really thick conglomerate. So you can see all these pebbles in here on top of this surface. And so what this is creating is a unconformity, because we're covering the existing rocks, in this case, these Paleozoic sedimentary rocks, with another sedimentary unit over some period of erosion. So we've got this erosional surface on which we're depositing these gravels. So there were mountains here shedding off these big gravels and cobbles into the valleys. Ultimately, though, we had volcanic activity start to really fire up in this region and produce several different types of volcanoes, including the classic sort of stratovolcano. So we had stratovolcanoes here. Of course, the volcanic edifice itself has long since eroded away, but we still have the deposits of ash and lava. There's thick andesitic lavas. There's a little bit of basalts in places, dacites, rhyolites, all sorts of different volcanoes here. Lava domes, which are these thick piles of pasty lava that just kind of wells up onto the surface and forms a steep-sided material. These stratovolcanoes occasionally would have big eruptions of ash, and that ash would fall and settle down on the landscape and form layers of tuff. So tuff is the bed of ash that we get when we have a really explosive eruption. And then sometimes there were intrusions of lava as well, what we sometimes call, these are sometimes, if they're shallow, like a lot of these are, we call them hip abyssal intrusions. And so a really complicated layer of the Challis Volcanics from the Eocene about 51 to 45 million years ago. And so this is sort of the landscape here. And what I'm gonna show you here where I'm standing is basically a point about like this. So I've got my feet on these older Paleozoic rocks, and then I've got this conglomerate right above me. And so let me show you these in a little bit better detail. These sort of brown platy limestones, the footing here is really lousy. But you can actually see some of the beds here of this platy limestone. So it's actually dipping to the northwest. There's a little bit more of it in outcrop over there. And I'm gonna wander up a little bit as best as the footing will allow. So across the way, you can see again more of these tan platy limestones down into the gully and down by the road there. And then we have this really sharp contact here and these massive conglomerates with these huge boulders in them. In fact, I think we can see the actual unconformity contact. Oh, this is great. This is fantastic right here. So here's this gray limestone from the Silurian period. This limestone is 430 million years old. It was laid down on the bottom of the ocean. And right above it are these conglomerates with these big cobbles in them. Oh, that scared me. That are about 50 million years old. So we've got an unconformity here of about 380 million years. And this is the erosional surface right here that my finger's kind of tracing. We can see a lot of these particles, these cobbles, are enormous. Some are a meter or so in diameter. Most of these are quartzites. This is a beautiful quartzite right here, which makes a lot of sense because if you drive along this part of the Salmon River, around the East Fork of the Salmon River, you'll see big outcrops of these older Paleozoic rocks, and the most resistant ones, the ones that stand out and make the biggest cliffs, are the quartzites. Quartzites are sandstones that have been highly compressed, maybe slightly metamorphosed, and they end up being really hard and durable. So this cobble of quartzite, as it's being tumbled down a river valley, is banging into the other rocks, chipping away the corners of those rocks, smashing and obliterating the softer rocks. But these turn out to be really, really hard. So most of these are quartzites. You don't see a lot of volcanics in the lower part of this. This is sometimes called the Smiley Creek conglomerate. But in places I've read that when you work your way up through the conglomerate, you start to see some of the volcanic material as the Challis volcanic episode kind of gets fired up. So again, these are just these really fast moving streams, highly energetic streams with lots of energy, enough energy and velocity to move these large particles. And so this surface here, this unconformity, would technically be an angular unconformity because we have these limestones oriented at an angle to the conglomerates. And so there's an angular relationship between these older sedimentary rocks below and these younger, more or less horizontally bedded, although it doesn't show a lot of bedding here, sedimentary rocks above. Pretty cool. Two of my more recent videos looked at two other types of unconformities down in Utah, a non-conformity, the Great Unconformity, and a buttress unconformity in Ogden Canyon. So here we have a third type of unconformity, an angular unconformity, where sedimentary rocks get deposited, then get tilted or rotated, so they're no longer horizontal, then some extensive period of erosion, and then other younger rocks getting deposited on top. We can see the same thing across the gully here with, this is all the Silurian limestone, and then there's the conglomerate up there. And so the contact here kind of winds its way up the hill and works its way up that way. So really awesome. Please watch part two of my quick little video here on, I'm gonna walk up to Malm Gulch and show you the petrified tree trunks there, the stumps. And then as a bit of an aside, I love doing these videos. They've been a great way to connect with people. I'm gonna put some stuff in the description on the videos where people want to support the videos a little bit. Gas prices are really expensive right now, and I would do these anyway, but if you want to lend a little bit of support, I can put a link to my Venmo and or a mailing address where you can send some support if you want to, but no big deal. But thanks for watching Malm Gulch in the East Central Mountains of Idaho.